This video will show how threads are used with blocking sockets compared to thread usage with non-blocking sockets. So first, a brief repetition of thread usage with blocking sockets. So with blocking sockets, there is a listening socket that accepts connection requests. It is an object of class server socket. This is the server socket. Connection request is made by some remote peer. There will be one thread continuously calling accept on this server socket. Let's call this thread T1. So it calls accept, then takes a new turn in the loop, calls accept again, and so on. And when a connection request is made, this connection request here, accept returns a communicating socket of the class socket. So this is the communicating socket, and the remote peer is connected with this communicating socket. Okay, and then the thread T1 spawns a new thread. Let's call it T2. And T2 communicates using this socket. It calls read and write. And if there are more sockets, the same thing happens all over again. Okay, so besides reading and writing, they of course also handle the request. Here are the calls to whatever other layers are needed to handle the request. Might be reading a file whose contents are returned, for example. So they read, handle the request, and write an answer. So that's thread usage with the blocking sockets. Here we can see that with this solution we have one thread per connection, the green and yellow ones in this example, plus one for the listening socket. With a large number of connections, there will be a large number of threads. And that is not so good, because that means a huge number of context switch. Because if we have more threads than we have CPU hardware threads, then CPUs will switch between the threads, and that takes time. Also thread handling, creating the threads and destroying the threads, takes time. Of course, we could, instead of having one connection, one thread per connection, we could have a thread pool with a fixed number of threads. That would be an advantage, because then we would not have to take the time of creating new threads whenever a connection is established. A thread pool with a fixed number of threads. The downside is that then we will have queued connections. If we have more connection attempts than there are threads in the pool, then the connection requests that does not get an allocated thread will have to wait for one of the other connections to finish and a thread to become available. Okay, so the problem with blocking sockets is that we will either have a queue of waiting connection requests, or we will have a context switch, because we will have many more connections than we have hardware threads in the CPU. Also, we will have idle threads, because for example the threads T2 and T3 here, they will have nothing to do between the read and write. They write an answer to the client, wait for another message from the client, and in between here the thread just sits blocking on the socket and has nothing to do. Also, if the handle operation performs some I/O, the thread is idle while the I/O operation is being performed. So we will have context switches between idle threads, which is not really an ideal solution. Now let's have a look at the thread usage with non-blocking sockets. Again, we have a listening socket, an object of class server socket. A connection attempt is made, and still someone must call accept. But now the socket will be non-blocking, so the call to accept will not block. Accept will not be called but when there is an awaiting connection request that can immediately be accepted. Okay, we will also have communicating sockets. Let's have two again. Objects of class socket that are created when the connection request is accepted. So there will be established connections on those sockets. And again, some thread must call read and write. Just like the accept call, the read and write calls will now be non-blocking, so no thread will ever be hung waiting for a message when having called read, and no thread will ever be hung on write waiting for the socket to be ready to accept the write message. So this means that the thread T1 now can do all these operations, call accept on the server socket and read and write on all the communicating sockets. And that is because there will be a selector. And the selector will know when it is possible to immediately accept a connection on the server socket and or read or write on any of the other sockets. So the selector will have the information about all operations that are possible to perform immediately without any waiting. So the thread T1 now just calls select on the selector, and the selector will tell which of the operations are possible to perform, which of all these operations can be performed without T1 being blocked. And T1 then can do that operation. So now we can have just one single thread performing all calls to the socket, and that is because all calls now are non-blocking. But what about the handling? The thread T1 will read a message, and it should be handled before, say the thread T1 reads this, and it should be handled before T1 can write the answer. Okay, that means T1 here must do the handling. And the handling might take some time, and it might be blocking. So it cannot be T1 doing that, but T1 instead hands over the handling to a thread pool. So the threads in the pool now takes a request that has been handed over by T1, does the handling, whatever it is, and returns the message that shall be returned. The task is handed over to the thread pool, and the result of the work done by the thread pool is handed back to the thread T1. So now, assuming a particular message arrives, let's follow exactly what happens. So the thread T1 reads a message here. It is the message is passed by T1 to this buffer or whatever is used to transfer the message over to the thread in the thread pool, which receives it, does whatever handling is required, reads files or performs computations or whatever that might take time, then returns the message back to the thread T1, which receives messages from the worker thread, and then T1 can write it back to the client. So that means we now have one thread, T1, plus the threads in the pool. And how many threads are needed in the pool? Well, that depends on the server and its task. But there is no need at all for one thread per connected client, as was the case when using blocking sockets. So all in all, we now have fewer threads, notably fewer threads, and thereby we can avoid context switching. We don't have to change thread working for a particular CPU hardware thread. We don't need more software threads than we have hardware threads, and thereby we avoid context switch, which makes it notably faster. We don't waste threads being blocked. By the way, this is the architecture used in, for example, Node.js, but it is by no means limited to Node.js. There are many servers in many different languages using this architecture. For example, there is a Java framework called Netty, which is quite widely used and is very useful for creating such applications. So this way of handling threads in combination with non-blocking sockets is used much too little, especially perhaps in Java programs. There is no limitation in the Java program or the Java APIs. It's very possible to do, and using Netty it is much easier than with just the plain Java NIO packages. So it should be used a lot more than it is normally used.